The first voice recording was made in 1860. It was a 10-second fragment of the French folk song Au clair de la lune recorded by inventor Edward Leon Scott de Martinville. But who will make the final voice recording and when? What will it be? Who will hear it? He walked out in the gray light and stood and he saw for a brief moment the absolute truth of the world. The cold relentless circling of the intestate earth. Darkness implacable. The blind dogs of the sun in their running. The crushing black vacuum of the universe. And somewhere 200 animals trembling like ground foxes in their cover. Borrowed time and borrowed world and borrowed eyes with which to sorrow it.
And lo, for the earth was empty of form, and void, and darkness was all over the face of the deep, and we said, look at that fucker dance.
Book club? That's the book club?
Yeah.
Pain club.
Wait. Book club.
What's a book club?
Yes, this
Explain
is the heat
to our
death
audience
of the
members
universe.
Who don't know what a book club is.
Book club. It's a brand new series where we read a book and we discuss it.
Amazingly, Josh and I had never read a book before. We finally decided to start. I know that we've recommended books at the end of the podcast, but that doesn't mean we've read them.
Yeah. We just heard about them.
New from like Tumblr and LiveJournal. and Zynga, that some people read books and it gets you in the in crowd, the Zynga in crowd, if you recommend them.
I don't even know what that is.
Was it Zynga? It was like a LiveJournal competitor.
Oh, okay.
A long time ago. You would know that clearly if you followed all the Angel Fire web pages that I do.
Yeah, I was in the dark and all that shit. I never even I missed LiveJournal as well.
I was a LiveJournal aficionado. It was great before Russia bought it.
Is that what happened?
Mm-hmm.
Well, speaking of people buying things, we bought a book, probably, called...
Someone bought a book and shared it to us and a lot of other people.
Yes, we read a book called Empire of Pain, The Secret History of the Sackler Dynasty, written by Patrick, Radden Keefe?
Right. Yeah, Radden Keefe.
And it's about the history of the Sackler family, who, if you don't know, are basically in a huge way responsible for the opioid epidemic in America over the last at least 20 something years.
Longer than that.
Yeah. I mean, the big stats that to show how serious it is, though, are that about 500,000 people have died directly from, prescription. I believe it involves street opiates as well, but in any case, opiates have killed like 500,000 people since 2000.
Yep.
And who knows? I mean, the numbers probably...
All the numbers are lower than they
are. Lower than
actuality.
They really should be, yeah. But yeah, we're going to discuss it in three parts, I think is what we've mostly settled on, because the book is broken up into three books within it.
Yeah.
We read the first 10 chapters in the prologue, and the first section is called The Patriarch, and we're going to talk about it.
Yeah. Do you want to go over the prologue first? Seems like a good
sure. start. It begins with like the deposition, right?
Yeah, I think it's the deposition, but for probably Massachusetts versus the Sackler family. I don't know if that's the exact name of the case, but it's where Mary Jo White, who is a famous lawyer, she was a district attorney. She fought the bad guys. She helped the government. She put down a lot of really bad people, where she's representing the Sackler family because she left government and decided to get rich by representing very powerful people for I don't know how to say that law firm's name. DeVore.
I don't either. That's probably right. Yeah.
One of the top like law firms for like rich assholes to, you know, get away with murder.
Yeah.
In this case, mass murder. versus Hanley, who is a Massachusetts lawyer and was fighting the good fight against the Sacklers.
And I think that the day in question is Kathy Sackler, who's the daughter of one of the original Sackler brothers.
Is that how you say her name?
You know, I didn't know either until I right this morning. I listened to an interview with the author, and I think he said her name. Or yeah. I watched like two videos about.
He's in the documentary, by the way, the author, a couple of times.
Yeah, we'll be referencing a documentary throughout this book club as well. That just came out called The Crime of the Century, which is about the same subject. It's like a two-part documentary about the opioid crisis. And the first half of it, the first 2 hours of it, is focused on the Sackler family side of it. And the second half is more about this, about fentanyl and another really terrible company that the Sacklers sort of paved the way for.
Yeah, I know from some skimming that Empire of Pain also gets into fentanyl in the third section.
Yeah, I'm curious to see.
Asking about that.
Curious to see where it goes with that. Also, the interview with the author, he talks about how the prologue starts, and he kind of like, he's a cool guy, this author. I like him. He's pretty like self-aware.
I like him too. I've read some of his New Yorker articles. His writing, I think, is good.
And he mentioned though that like someone like, you know, close to him who, you know, likes his work but is like an honest critic to him, was like, "Really, you want to start the book with like a deposition?" And he's like, "But depositions are like thrilling to me." That's the kind of guy this is. Like, I guess my point in saying that is that he did a lot of research for like many years behind this book, and you can really tell like kind of from the get go. But I don't know what stood out to you in the prologue. I'm trying to think about it. I mean, I can go through my Kindle notes here, but
I think the big things that stand out to me in the prologue is at least what they capture of like Hanley cross-examining Kathy is basically Kathy never admits guilt to Oxycontin actually killing people. That it's always the refrain is it's a good drug, that it's the user's fault if they get hurt by it, which is like the Sackler refrain. Just like this family of like psychopaths who will never admit that maybe they made a product that like literally just addicts people and kills them.
Yeah, that is kind of it's like laying the foundation for that, which is obviously going to be a theme throughout the book of this how much or how little the family members here like take responsibility for what they've done or are in like some weird actual denial about it. That was another thing with the author. He was saying that like he thinks a lot of the story of the family is about people who are in like deep denial about reality.
Oh yeah, I get that feeling about them every time I watch them.
Yeah, like they really seem to believe their shit. Like you can tell when certain people are just like, you know, lying through their teeth. And
like the Life Tree Clinic guy, I think was just lying through his teeth.
Yeah,
which is
yeah.
like a whole nother thing. But
that's a good example of someone. I mean, I guess we're going to be kind of bouncing around back and forth between the documentary and the book. But in the documentary, there is this like one of the most reprehensible people in this whole like saga of the opioid epidemic, and he runs a pain clinic, and he's just like clearly subsidized by like these fentanyl like companies. And I don't remember if he was directly connected to the Sacklers or not. Probably, I can't remember, but this guy was just like, I'm amazed he even sat down for the interview, to be honest, because he just seems like he's like implicating himself in like crimes. Like, anyway, this particular guy would like just load people up on like insane amounts of prescription medicine and just have them absolutely hooked. And
I mean, I think that he didn't care to sit down for the interview because he'd already been acquitted of any crimes he was ever charged with.
Oh yeah, that's why he was so fucking smug in the interview too.
Yeah, he'd already been
I can't remember his name either, by the way. He's just
Weber, right?
I don't know.
His last name's Weber, I'm pretty sure. I can't remember his first name. Like Dr. Weber.
Well, if you watch the documentary, you'll know who we're talking about. He's like the most like obviously evil on the surface level. But I think that like a big thing that we're like that I want to like kind of talk about throughout the whole book probably is like motivations of the Sackler family and the individuals within it. And like, yeah. did they start off like with noble intentions? Did they just like accidentally get to where they are? Like, and I should say what we've covered so far in the first 10 chapters is it's really just laying the foundations. It actually hasn't even gotten into the point where they're making OxyContin yet, which is their big, you know, contribution to the opioid epidemic. But it's like, you know, it's called the Patriarch, and the Patriarch, we should say, is Arthur Sackler, who is the oldest brother of this family. The parents were immigrants from Eastern Europe. They like lived in Brooklyn. It was like kind of a very typical like I don't know, rags to riches like immigrant story, I guess.
Yeah. American dream story.
Like really hard workers. Like for all the evil that is associated with the Sackler name, like, I guess credit where credit's due, like, Arthur Sackler was a incredibly, like, motivated, hardworking kid, and then young man, and so on, and, like, all the way up until his death. Like, I think it said that even right before he died, he was working, like, 7 days a week.
He was the born thing with is, the ability to pull bootstraps. That was made out of bootstraps.
He was just a human bootstrap mess.
You could say a Gordian knot of bootstraps.
Yes, just tugging on himself all the time. I guess we should just like kind of run through. I mean, these opening 10 chapters really do just focus mostly on him. He was like a, you know, naturally smart guy. He read, you know, he liked reading and learning, and went to some weird like sort of private prep school or something.
Yeah,
in New York
Aramis.
Erasmus?
Oh, is it Erasmus? I thought it was called Aramis, but
I thought. Well, anyway, like
it doesn't matter.
The famous the philosopher guy is. I thought it was Erasmus. Maybe
that's
I'm
possible.
Maybe I'm mispronouncing it. In any case, he got like a very classical education. He liked, you know.
Yeah, I think.
But his parents, of course,
I just can't read.
His parents wanted, like, you know, all three of the boys of the family to be doctors, which they all eventually would get, like, their medical degrees. And I think the important part to mention is, like, a big turning point for Arthur Sackler was he started working at this, it's not a PC term anymore, or whatever woke term, but insane asylum. This, like, you know, man, insane asylums were horrible places and
yeah,
like still are
horrible
today, but like they used to be really fucking bad. But, the one he worked at was like, it was like overcrowded by like, I think it was supposed to have like 4,000 people, but it had 6,000. And just those numbers itself, I don't know, I can't imagine. I've worked sort of in environments like that, but
I've never worked inside an institution, but I did have like actually for like 3 years I worked for like a home healthcare service where I would I guess take care of like mentally ill people.
Just imagine, like, multiply job. By 6,000, I guess.
Yeah, I can't imagine.
But, go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, some of the events at Creedmoor, I think, actually kind of filled the Sackler brothers with some noble intentions, but I think money, as usual, and profit corrupted those.
Yeah, I agree. So I think, yeah, eventually all three brothers were working at this same place. Yeah, it was called Creedmoor, like you said. Yeah,
Creedmoor.
This mental hospital. And
funny fact, just a small funny fact, if I remember correctly, Creedmoor is what Arkham Asylum is based on.
Is that
from
so?
From the original Batman comics, yes.
Hmm. I guess that makes sense. It seemed sort of like an Arkham-y place. So of course, like at this time, like, you know, even psychiatry was like not, it wasn't revered the way it is now, at least like in the medical field. But that was something he was interested in. He like became interested in like Freudianism. But he was also a medical doctor, and then he saw like how electroshock therapy was being used at these places. And there's an interesting part that I didn't have any idea about the origins of electroshock therapy. Like it said it was, I can't find it, but anyway, it was basically some Italian psychiatrist got the idea by seeing pigs being electrocuted.
Yep.
And, yeesh, I found it right here. Observing how pigs were stunned with a jolt of electricity just before they were killed, he devised a procedure in which electrodes were placed on the temples of a human patient so that a current of electricity would be administered to the temporal lobe and other regions of the brain where memory is processed. It doesn't say here, but I guess his thinking was like, I'll get rid of the bad memories. I don't know.
Just jolted out of them.
It's very primitive thinking. But so, I mean, to the Sacklers' credit, they thought this was inhumane, and they thought there's got to be a better way.
Yeah, they were kind of the pioneers of thinking that depression and mental instability was like a chemical imbalance.
I mean, they are and they aren't. Like, I think the author kind of glosses over the history of psychology and stuff like that a little bit too much there, because they were, I mean, even even Freud, like, you know, had some inklings about the brain. I mean, the fucking ancient Greeks had ideas that the brain was like, you know, the locus of thought. But what I would say they were pioneers in was the idea that we can come up with a pill to cure like any mental ailment. It was like that was their idealism, I guess. And that's what they set out to do. They did like, they started doing tests with like histamine, that were, seemed very suspiciously bad, like bad science.
But, I'm a daily histamine user.
And bad has allergies. Cured you of all your mental ailments.
No, I just have terrible allergies. Otherwise, I wouldn't be able to go outside.
I remember the description of that was like, it was like, one day in the insane asylum, the brothers just decided to electrocute a rabbit to see what would happen. I was like, what the fuck? And they're like, they noticed the blood vessels in its ears, it's pretty gruesome, like, were like inflamed. And they thought, ah, histamine. If we just inject people's brains with histamine, that'll get rid of their schizophrenia. Like, I don't know. It's just so like, and I understand like how science works. Like, it's a history of trial and error. And I'm judging this from, you know, the vantage point of 2021.
Yeah, but I mean, still,
it's like, it's hard not to sort of like scoff at.
In the brothers' defense, their job was like, I mean, as doctors at Creedmoor, I think it said they administered more than like thousands of electroshock therapies.
Yeah, they were personally doing it, and they were like repulsed by it.
And they were disgusted by it. So I think they probably had hit like the breaking point of like, God, fuck, there has to be something better. Just anything, like grasping at straws sort of place.
That's true. I agree with that. But yeah, I guess the importance of this is that it sets into motion this idea that better living through chemistry. What was that DuPont?
Yeah.
But the idea that like psychiatry is going to be the wave of the future, and that, you know, feeling anxious, take a pill. Feeling this, take a pill. That kind of thing, which we're all like very familiar with in the present day. But when they were working at the mental hospital, these were pretty new kind of claims, I guess. And I mean, I don't know what happens after that. Like I think the way that they all end up getting tossed out of Creedmoor, because they don't leave on their own accord, was because of they were being investigated for being communists.
Yeah, I think so.
Which I found sort of interesting as well, considering that, you know, we're talking about this book and obviously attacking them somewhat from an angle of like, how much they prize profit over everything else. But at one point it seemed at least one of the two brothers, if not all three of them, were sincerely, I think one of them was literally a member of the Communist Party.
Yeah, I think so too. They grew up in the Depression. They had watched their father, who, Isaac Sackler, who had started like a grocery business in New York and was like a successful business owner, small business owner, like lose everything during Depression. I think that leads a lot of people to believing that maybe laissez-faire capitalism is a bit broken.
Yeah, that makes sense. And I'm just totally guessing here, but I think if you ask like Arthur Sackler or any of the brothers like later in life about that time, they would probably be like, oh, that was like youthful stupidity of, you know, when we thought communism was a good idea.
Yeah.
In any case, what does Arthur Sackler do next? His big contribution next is, I guess, to the world of advertising, right?
World of advertising and Valium too.
Yeah, I mean he's an ad man first though, right?
Yeah, he ends up at I think even while he's working at Creedmoor,
he was doing simultaneous. Yeah.
He works at McAdams, which is the first major medical advertising firm, and they have that their first big ads are these strange ads that no one was exactly sure what was going on. It was Terramortha or something.
Yeah, for penicillin or antibiotics.
Yeah.
Different antibiotics. Yeah. Yeah, that was another interesting thing about the author described it as I can't remember now, but it was something like first wave antibiotics, second wave antibiotics, third wave antibiotics. I don't think the word was wave, but it was basically saying or it was maybe narrow medicines versus wider medicines. So the plan of the drug companies was we can use this antibiotic for a while, but then eventually resistance builds up to it and we've got to move on to the next one. But we're not going to just say, hey, we're moving on to the next one. We're going to say, hey, this is a new thing that can treat even more ailments. And, this is going to be a big part of the book.
This usually
is people just lying about what medicines can do.
Well, it also usually coincides with patents being released. And
right, yeah.
Because the moment that the intellectual property rights let up on a drug, the manufacturer starts making way less money as generics hit the market.
I was wondering about that, though. I guess I just don't know enough about intellectual property, but how do these, how does Pfizer and so on, I always assumed that, once they got a patent on something, they could just keep renewing it, indefinitely.
No, there's a statute of, it's a statute of limitation for, drugs. I think it's
20 years. That's sort of surprising to me that there's even that small bit of regulation in the United States. Yeah,
well, actually, I think it's everywhere with patents except for film and media. And funnily enough, it doesn't exist as much in film and media because of the big old mouse.
Disney pushed to have infinite IP.
Basically, Disney made a giant push to make sure that their stuff was never taken by someone else.
Interesting.
Which
yeah,
is something I've read about, but I don't know all the exact details. But
Disney, yeah, I need to read more about that too, because I wonder how these patents are issued on drugs, in terms of how long they have. I mean, it seems like it's at least several years, but maybe it depends on the drug and the circumstance. But because, that does come up pretty soon here in the chronology of
20 years in the United States. Sorry, I just wanted to ask Google how long drug patents last, because I wasn't sure if it was 20 or 25 years.
Okay, so there's just a base number for all patented drugs.
So you.
But then,
generic drugs start to appear 20 years later.
Okay. I almost just said something so dumb. I was gonna go, hey, but then what about Tylenol? Don't they have the market cornered on acetaminophen? Oh wait, no, of course not.
Tylenol came out a long time ago.
There's a million generic versions of acetaminophen. But anyway, it's too bad they can't fucking speed that process up with the fucking vaccines, but don't get me started on that.
We can wait 20 years, dude.
Yeah, we've got time.
No problem.
There'll be, 17 million different variants in India by then? Then they can finally get vaccinated? Cool.
I mean, according to my doctor friends in America, the pandemic is endemic now, and it's just something we have to live with forever, like the measles or the chicken pox.
Yeah,
Well, we've already lost.
That's hopefully that's what it turns into, because I mean, like, I'm pretty sure the measles don't kill hundreds of thousands of people a year. I'm just going to guess.
Not anymore.
All right. Sorry, I shouldn't have brought up COVID shit. Couldn't help it.
I mean, these antibiotics are the first time the Sackler families kind of get in trouble, from what I understand.
What happens with that? I don't really remember, actually.
So the first, like, before they met Henry Welsh, which was the FDA, like, the FDA guy, they were, O'Lear was this investigated reporter who was, like, started investigating Arthur Sackler and started to realize that he was, like, connected to, like, McAdams and also connected to Purdue Pharmacy and connected to Pfizer and connected to Creedmoor and connected to, like, basically everything because he's an octopus. That with these original runs of vaccines where they were, like, being, like, more and more narrow, and also realizing it was untenable to just prescribe them willy-nilly because people are just going to get more and more resistant to the vaccine. I keep saying vaccines, and I mean to say antibiotics. Sorry. They started to look into the case and wanted to charge them, but just because of, like, layers and layers of ossification from Arthur, he never was, like, really got in trouble. He ended up making friends with, like, Henry Welsh from the FDA, who kind of helped him get off of everything. That's how I remember it running.
Yeah, that's right. That was like in the 50s then. That was pretty early on. It's a little confusing, the timeline, because, like we said already, this Arthur Sackler guy, like, he would have, like, 16 projects going all at once. And on top of that, we find out he's, like, has this, like, almost pathological, like, penchant for secrecy, like, in all areas of his life. He was, like, the type of guy who had, like, secret families and shit. And, like, you know, multiple mistresses or whatever.
The book doesn't talk about his first marriage that much. Actually, they talk more about his first wife after he marries his second wife, which I think is funny. I think he became closer to his first wife after his second marriage.
It's because they had, like, business dealings together, though, too, I think. Like, he was using her as, like, a way to protect himself. So it was, like, she had certain, like, shares in whatever, you know, company. I mean, the thing is with this guy is, like, you know, he started off with good intentions. I think by this point in the story, his good intentions can fuck off, because he's doing a lot of, like, clearly evil shit.
Well, he kind of he dies before OxyContin's released. I think he might have even died before M-Cotton was released, which is, like, the precursor of OxyContin from Purdue. I'm not sure about that. He died in 1987. M-Cotton. Yeah. So the M-Cotton patent lifted in 1996, because that's when OxyContin came out.
MS-Cotton, which is...
Yeah, MS-Cotton.
Which is the morphine, slow-release morphine pill.
Yeah, which is... I mean, its patent being released is why they eventually... why they rushed to make OxyContin, because they needed to figure out a new drug to make Purdue a ton of money.
And it just so happened that that one is, like, 50 times stronger and more addictive than even morphine.
Yep.
Yeah. I'm just thinking, like, maybe getting a little ahead of ourselves. No, it's fine. I mean... we're going to be kind of jumping all over the place. We can't help it, really, with a story like this.
Conversation about a book.
Right. I forgot. Podcasting puts me into a weird mental space where I'm like, where are we? What's the deal? but actually, where were we? So, like, the brush with the law. He has, like, his first... I mean, I guess there were multiple brushes of the law. There was the thing with the, like, communist thing, but that was pretty insignificant. But yeah, finally, like, some people do, like, the government in some small way does start to see that this guy is, like, you know, has his hands in, like, way too many pies. How does it go?
Syringes,
yeah. He escapes, like, scot-free. But I think where he was actually sort of revolutionary, it seems, was in how he changed the medical advertising game. And that's, like, a really significant thing, especially considering what this family ends up doing in the 90s. Well, in the 60s, actually, rather, but...
Yeah, they did kind of the same...
They did exactly the same thing.
To less destruction, but they did the same thing with Valium.
Yeah, and... But before they even get into the Valium game, the Sackler family, Arthur Sackler here, in the overlapping time between when Arthur Sackler was still working at Creedmoor Mental Institution and also started working as an ad man was it called McAdams?
McAdams.
He became basically like the Don Draper of prescription drug advertising. I mean,
yeah. Sometimes reading Keefe's account of him, like, is he just referencing Don Draper, or was Don Draper based on Sackler?
I don't. I mean, you know what I just realized in total retrospect? The title of this chapter is called Med Man.
No, I saw that.
I didn't notice it though until just now. Like, I think I texted you when I was reading it. I was like, man, I couldn't help but think about, like, Mad Men and Don Draper or whatever. And then I'm realizing, like, well, no shit. Like, this, it's even titled Med Man.
Med Man's also the one where he meets Vanno, who I think is also maybe part of the. He helped design. He was like his mentor. Or psychology stuff.
The Freudian guy?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. That was part of his, like, obsession with Freud. And, yeah, he was obsessed with, what was his name?
Vanno.
Yeah, he was just some, he was, like, a disciple of Freud.
Yeah.
So I just have this little bit here, like, sums up, like, the change in the advertising world, though. How do you sell a pill? Arthur's answer was to adopt the seductive pizzazz of more traditional advertising, catchy copy, splashy graphics, and to market directly to an influential constituency, the prescribers. So that's the big thing, is that, you know, they're going to bypass the consumers. And also, apparently, there are laws preventing pharmaceutical companies from directly advertising to consumers.
Yeah.
But the whole thing, and what gets to this, like, crazy fever pitch out of control shit, which, like, is really shown really well in the documentary, especially with that
sales guy,
Synergistic, whatever the fuck that company was called. I'm just going to call them the fentanyl inhaler company.
The lollipop company?
Yeah, the lollipop and inhaler fentanyl brand. God, those corporate...
Fentanyl lollipops, what the fuck?
Those corporate videos are so insane.
I know.
So insane. When the white guy come out and he's doing, like... I mean, he's just doing, like, a kind of, like, black preacher thing, right? Do you remember this part?
I do.
And he's like, and this is in front of just a group of, like, advertising people, whatever. And he just starts singing, you know, you make me want to sell OxyContin. And he just starts singing this, like, Weird Al-esque parody song where they're literally saying, like, let's keep pushing Oxy. Like, that's just literally the lyrics of this song. And it was like, oh man, the 90s was a different time. Anyway, I think this is the big turn, though, which is like, and this is what leads to like a lot of the illegality from the Sacklers, is like, it just turns into like bribing doctors directly, buying people off.
Yeah, because the
as a way of pushing their drugs.
To be like, prescribe my drugs, we'll give you big pushbacks, big bonuses for prescribing my drug instead of the competitor's drug, becomes like the model.
And the way they would get in on the ground floor with a drug, it was, and this was proven, it's written out in the book in detail, but like they had a list. I forget, this must have been for either Valium or Librium. When they first tried to start selling them, and it was like all of these endorsement quotes from different doctors, and like someone looked into it and none of those doctors
existed.
None of
the doctors are real. Yeah.
They're complete fabrications. And that's the thing. And then like, you know, he realized like this simple flaw, which is that like doctors also can be gullible like anybody else, and
certainly
so even if they're not like just being outright bought off, they'd be like, oh well, if 10 doctors are saying this is good, well then I'll sign off on it, I'll prescribe it to people. And they also just believe the totally bogus claims about the drug, which have no studies to back them up. Like to this day, OxyContin, the Purdue company will tell you only 1% of people will get addicted to OxyContin. And that's more on the person misusing it.
What was the FDA line about OxyContin? The one that all the sales reps had to remember? I fucking forgot already.
Well, one of them was the 1% thing, but I don't. You mean the guy from West Virginia kept saying? I can't remember. It's like it's the kind of legalese jargon where it's like, it is believed that, OxyContin is capable of possibly doing blah blah blah, and then people just read it as like, oh, look at this fact.
Yeah, I think it was what it is believed that time released. The time release mechanism, whatever, keeps people from getting addicted, something along those lines.
Yeah, that's the big push it was first with that MS content and then OxyContin as well. The whole time release makes it less addictive. If you slowly trickle an opiate that's 100 times more powerful than heroin into your body, then you won't get addicted, you see. That's science.
No way.
And yeah, not a single study. Like, they couldn't even bother to get, like, make a bullshit study. Like, there's no evidence for any of their claims at all. And, I mean, this is more stuff we're going to get into probably on the next episode, I'm guessing, the next middle section of the book.
The middle section of the book is OxyContin.
Yeah. But here in the early days, like kind of the precursor to the way they handled rolling out the painkillers, was they got Arthur Sackler. I forget exactly how. It doesn't really matter. He somehow got connected with a chemist or a drug company, and he was working on something basically to relieve anxiety. I guess that was the point from the beginning. It turned out to be what we know as Librium, which I did not know until I read this book. Was a portmanteau for liberation and equilibrium.
I didn't know that either. That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
Did they say that in the book? Because I completely missed it.
It is in the book, but I mean, it's something that's you okay. could like zoom yeah. by pretty. It's like a throwaway line.
I must have been in one of those states where I was just reading.
Yeah, I mean, we can talk about, like, I like this book a lot. It's very interesting. I gotta say when I got, so there's 10 chapters, I guess 11 if we count the prologue that we've read so far. I think like the last like 3 or 4 chapters that we read, I was getting a little like, I was getting kind of tired of reading about it, about Arthur Sackler and his like art collecting life.
I don't think you'll have to read about him anymore after the first book, though.
No, I know. I'm just saying, I'm just giving my like my impression of the book, like how yeah, I was really, really enjoying the first like 5 or 6 chapters because it was like, it was really taking us through this history of this guy, and like I could see like why. And I can see why the stuff that's included, like throughout all of it, is. But at a certain point, I was just like, okay, like he's glad handing everybody. He's like setting up his legacy. I get it.
Yeah, I think the art collecting has to be in there. I felt the same way, but I think the art collecting has to be in there because, like, sure, he's collecting all this Chinese art. Like, he's obsessed with Chinese art. But he's definitely starts use as he becomes richer and richer from Valium, because they make a shit ton of money from Valium. He's also looking I think he knows that like people are getting addicted to Valium. Like they're mainly advertising to doctors, and it's mainly being prescribed to women, and it turns into like a problem. Like Valium, the original run of Valium, turns into a problem because they want it just prescribed to basically everyone.
For anything. It was like first date jitters, Papa Librium, and a Valium.
I think he knows even then that, oh shit, maybe everyone doesn't need this. But and I think that's why he keeps his name off of like Pardue. He keeps his name off of any of the medicine stuff because he wants his name to be associated with art and philanthropy.
Yeah, and like culture. He's actually,
I think he's obsessed with being like, I think he wanted to like, even the book says this, but he's obsessed with his family being part of the old money club.
Yeah, like they like to pretend that they weren't new money. Like that's a through line too, is like people don't know where the Sackler's money came from because he just like wouldn't say. And like, well, and probably also because being like, oh, we made our fortune off of this kind of controversial drugs, like, because that's initially how they get truly rich, is through Librium and then Valium. Valium was their way of continuing to ride the wave when like the patent ran out on Librium. Is that right, or did they just double down and want to make more money? I think
they were kind of concurrent.
I think it was just doubling down. It was like, oh wait, yeah, we can say Valium is for like a different kind of anxiety or something like that.
Yeah, I think that like Librium was for depression, and then Valium was for anxiety, and like they basically marketed them in two different ways.
Yeah, but they're like, I think chemically they're pretty similar. I don't know. I've never actually popped those particular pills, but
I think I've tried Valium some point. Been a while. Definitely never tried Librium.
Yeah, Valium is still made today. I'm pretty sure Librium is like a relic of the past.
Yeah, I think so too.
But an important thing about that whole time too is that, and we've already mentioned this, but like, you know, eventually the family line for the Sacklers is going to be basically like OxyContin is an amazing wonder drug that helps people. If anyone gets hurt from it, that's their problem. And he said the same, Arthur Sackler's laid the groundwork for that. He said the same exact thing about Valium and Librium. He said the drug's not the issue, it's misuse, it's the user.
Yeah, he very much preached personal responsibility. It's never the corporation. It's never the business's fault. It's the consumer.
Well, also, what almost pisses me off more, like, I mean, that pisses me off too, but like, this guy was such a snob, especially like once he got past his more humble roots and wanted to be this old money guy. And he was always kind of like puffing himself up as this intellectual and like a man of science and a man of medicine and shit. And what he's saying there about drugs and use is like the most anti-scientific thing you could say. Like, not to mention the fact that they didn't subject their drugs to any real scientific rigor at all. They just made up fucking doctor's quotes. Like, this guy was not the intellectual that he thought he was. Like, and he certainly wasn't the humanitarian that he thought he was. That was a whole other thing is like, it's like, you know, we're making the world a better place and all this shit. And, I think that's where
looking for ways to get his names on various museums. Like, part of me thinks it's kind of funny how he, tugged around the Met by basically being like, if you house all of my art and like assign some curators to it, keep it private from the public, I'll eventually donate all of it to you.
He used the Met as a fucking storage locker.
He did.
He was like, so I guess we should say he becomes obsessed at a certain point. I think, well, I want to say it's post, like, it must be. I mean, this is after they're already rich. It's
post-family fortune, yeah.
Probably when, you know, they're not even, I don't know when they stopped making money from Valium, but I know, you know, the patent did run out or whatever at some point, but
probably 75. I think the patent came out in 55.
Okay. And, so at some point, though, I think it was in the 70s, maybe. It doesn't matter, really. But this guy gets this fucking wild hair up his ass about Chinese antiquities. And as he's, like, known to do, he becomes, like, obsessive and secretive and stuff about, like, this pursuit of, like, he wants to have the greatest collection of, like, Chinese antiquities and Chinese art. And but it's, like, piling up in his house, or his houses, I should say. And yeah, at one point when he sort of shifts to becoming to having the public face of a philanthropist, he donates enough stuff to the Met to where he can like make them his bitch, basically.
Yeah, I think he like paid for their air conditioning unit or something.
It was something like that. Yeah, he gave them a big donation, or probably multiple ones. And we know with the, you know, the standard thing, like, you know, put my name on a plaque, you know, call this the Sackler Gallery. But also, I want you to wall off like a section of the museum where I can keep my personal collection, and like, and put an office for like one of my fucking corrupt guys who works with me. And like it said, like the people who worked at the Met didn't know what was going on, like behind this one wall. There was just like this secret wall where they're like, what is that? And like, and I think Sackler's like terms were like, and nobody can know what I'm doing in here. Like it was literally something like only he and his business associate had a key to get in there, which is just, it's like a hilarious, just show of like, I don't know, privilege and power and like it really going to your head type of thing. Like he's like, I got nowhere to put this stuff. And it's like, he's rich as hell. Like he could just buy another house even to, he could make his own museum, but you know, anyway, like when he goes into the philanthropy game, there's an important quote in the book from, Arthur Sackler's lawyer, actually, who points out something that we all probably know, but which is like, once you put your name on it, it's no longer charity. Like it's a business transaction.
Yeah.
And all of their quote unquote philanthropic work was just, putting their name on this stuff because he wanted it to be associated, like you said, with like high culture and stuff like that.
Yeah, and eventually he gets his name, like even, I think this was after, or I guess while he was hosting his stuff at the Met is when like the Egyptian president of the time donates like the Temple of Dendur to the Met. And I think Arthur Sackler helped like arrange that because he wanted to like have like
a public wing of the museum that had like the Temple of Denver and like some of his collection, like not all of it, but some of his collection. But he wanted to make sure that every piece of the art that was on public display was like provided by the Sackler family.
Right.
There's some like weird stuff too of authors' marriages that aren't really touched on in the book, but I thought interesting. Like there's the first wife who he always keeps connection with. Then there's Marietta, who was a German doctor who fled to America after World War II. But like the book does mention that she was married to a Nazi officer.
Yeah. And the Sacklers are Jewish, by the way.
Yeah.
And yeah, there's a lot of kind of weird stuff you can infer about like the psychology of Arthur Sackler through the there is a fair amount of stuff about the marriages. I don't know how much of it is really.
I think he just wanted to own everything.
I mean, any
of the wives were like necessarily what normal people consider law. I think it was just all conquest for him. I think his whole life was just conquest.
Yeah, and there's in the documentary, there's a interview with him when he's, I don't know, he looks like he's towards the end of his life. But he's talking about the pursuit of the object. And he's talking, you know, he's talking about antiques.
Yeah, he's talking about collecting art.
But he's like, he's talking about it in such a weird, like almost erotic way where he's like, you have to really focus your sights in the pursuit of the object. It won't just come to you. Like, that's really what he says. Yeah. And, yeah, I agree. Like, I mean, the way they talk about him pursuing Marietta, the German woman, was like, you know, she wasn't really interested, and he was just, like, kind of relentless. And, but then he was ultimately, like, an asshole to everyone around him in the long run. I mean, I think something that one quote about, like, his character was very quickly summed up as like he could be charming, but he was ultimately just purely selfish, something like that.
Yeah, because in later life he ends up with Jillian, who was like what, 50 years his younger.
Yeah, he did the typical thing of like when he's old and realizing, you know, he can't live forever, now it's time to get a really young wife. That he basically just like kept around as another art object. But what else happens in the beginning of this? I mean, there's a lot of interesting detail. Like, I kind of like the stuff just in the very beginning, it's just not that important to the overall like story, but I just enjoyed reading the descriptions of like early 20th century, I don't know, New York.
Oh, me too.
Like immigrant life. I thought that was pretty well done and interesting. And
I thought even the descriptions of Creedmoor and the asylum at that time was interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. I don't know. I feel like we almost kind of covered everything in a sort of roundabout way. But
so,
yeah.
So like, The way the first book ends, I'll just get on that for a bit. It's called, the last chapter is called To Thwart the Inevitable. I can speak. I can say English words. And it's basically after Marietta has attempted suicide in front of Art because of he refuses to sign divorce papers. After she finds out about Jillian, because he hates the idea that he can't have both Marietta, Jillian, and Ella.
I don't know how to say that person's name. It's literally spelled Else. And
it is spelled Else.
It was making me mad. Some of the names were pissing me off in this book. So I was like, how do you say that out loud? Like Kathy spelled K-A-T-H-E. Kaith? Anyway, sorry.
But in the last chapter, he talks about being married to Jillian because she is a younger woman, and he feels like,
having someone that young around makes him young again because he's around like this youthful energy. And this is when he starts pouring like tons of money into like every museum. Like not just like at first it's just like the Met, but at this point he puts like he has a wing opened in the Fog, which is like Harvard's art museum. He has like something opened in the Smithsonian. Actually, he ends up donating a lot of the Temple of Denver to the Smithsonian, which is confusing to me because I was under the impression the temple was originally donated to the Met, but I guess it was donated to Sackler. And he had rights for where it was going to go. But yeah, it just gets into like how he wants to get his name everywhere, which I thought was interesting.
Well, yeah,
his family takes over the business.
Yeah, the chapter's to thwart the inevitability of death. And, like, yeah, the whole thing is about how he wants, like, immortality through his name if he can't have it otherwise. And so he's, like up until the point when he dies, and that's where this ends, really, is with his death. But, like, he was such a strange guy, secretive guy, that he went to the hospital with like he realized he had like chest pains and thought, I guess I had a heart attack earlier. And then he goes to the hospital and checks into the hospital under an assumed name, doesn't tell anyone in his family, and dies. And so, like, you know, no one got a chance to say goodbye to him. I mean,
oh, but then like he
that really I don't know, that seems weirdly selfish and weird, strange to me as well.
They had that massive funeral and there were some interesting people that attended. Like, I think the Koch brothers was there for 100% sure. George H.W. Bush was there because they were friends. Like, there was a point where he tried to give George H.W. Bush like money while he was still living.
Yeah, there was a really big like memorial service or something for him. And I think it was largely because of like all of his quote unquote philanthropy. Yeah.
But the whole first section of the book, just a little more on it, it just sets up how secretive the family is. Like, we didn't touch on this, but Mortimer's son killed himself and the family just like completely snuffed it out. They're like, no. No one talks about this.
Yeah, I forget who. There's a lot of names to keep straight. His mother, whoever his mother was, Marcella or something. I don't know. She was like going through family photos with, maybe it was the widow of her son.
Yeah, I think so.
And like when they would get to pictures with him, she would like quickly toss them aside. Like it was like he didn't exist.
He didn't exist anymore.
Like she continued to like work and live in the room that he jumped out of. Like he had a really grisly suicide.
Yeah, because he had ended up addicted to drugs.
Oh right, he was addicted to drugs, which is another thing that the family had, you know, doesn't want anyone to know about. Yeah.
Some other interesting things about authors. He hated big tobacco.
Yeah, all I remember reading in passing was one of his things he hated most in life was cigarettes. But I guess by extension he would hate the industry too.
He hated big tobacco, and what's funny about that is they're probably the clearest analog to Purview.
Oh yeah,
as far as like marketing something as safe and beneficial, and it's killing millions. I say this as I sit here vaping like a madman, but I guess vape's not big tobacco. It's just the
well, there's a difference between saying tobacco's bad and using it, and then saying tobacco's bad and then making heroin for people and saying that it's not addictive.
Yeah.
So don't be too hard on yourself, man. Yeah, that's the type of shit when we talked about like denial. Like that to me is like that has to be some crazy level of denial. Like, I don't even think he's lying. I think he probably really did hate big tobacco and just didn't see himself as an analog to that at all.
Yeah, I don't think they saw
Well, although, I mean, Arthur Sackler didn't see, you know, the opioid chapter of the Sackler history, but they were doing really the same thing. I don't know if people even really die from Valium.
Yeah, but Valium became a giant problem.
It was a problem with addiction, but it wasn't like an epidemic of overdoses either. I mean, I'm not trying to. Well, I am saying one is much worse than the other.
No, codeine's worse. Heroin's worse.
But the basic principle of how it was marketed and how the consumer was blamed for its misuse, all is exactly the same.
Well, I think one of the big differences too about the tobacco industry and like the pharmaceutical industry, as in the pharmaceutical industry being the heroin pushing industry, is that big tobacco eventually got their comeuppance. Like, they got a giant fine, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, they did and they didn't. I mean, like, those guys are all still fucking rich.
That's true.
Cigarettes are still, I mean.
But to this day, even with, like, earlier this year with the Boston stuff finally clearing, the Sacklers have never been punished. Not truly. Everything they've had has just been fucking speeding tickets.
I guess I don't have the numbers in front of me, and I know they were in the book about big tobacco, but it's
big
not
tobacco
like,
was like $220 billion fine, which still
yeah, but that was like spread out between like all the major companies, and yeah. It's not like it bankrupted them. Marlboro still exists.
Well, I think one of the big things with tobacco is they their privileges to advertise was revoked.
Yeah. I mean, okay, so they're not conquering the world as much as they used to, because there's way less people smoke now, arguably because of, I guess, partly because of those big lawsuits and the, like, curtailing the ads and stuff. But, like, I think they've just adapted and they just, like, they've doubled down, like, on, like, selling cigarettes in other countries where they don't give a shit about stuff like that.
Yeah, like here.
Yeah, or I mean, even in, I would say, like, probably, yeah. In any case, like, and we're going to see a lot more of this, I think, in the next section of the book, but, like, the idea of the government, when they finally do go after companies that have, like, so clearly, like, killed people. nobody goes to jail. Nobody, and nobody's financially ruined even. Like,
no.
Like, because I think one of the big fines on the Sacklers was like $600 million.
It's nothing to them.
And their family worth is like $19 billion, and it's probably way more than that, like off book, you know? Yeah, I mean, you see. And the thing is the government is just as complicit in a lot of it too, because they're like, hey, look, we did our job. Look at this big number that we slapped on these people. And it's like, people will
this
see
comes
that
later, but they like own parts of the government.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
And they own politicians. They own FDA members. They own.
Yeah. I mean, there's a reason. Oh, and yeah. And that's the other thing is, their business practices just continue the same way, like more or less. It's like, hey, yay, we gave you a fine. Doesn't that satisfy the public? And the thing is a lot of times it does satisfy the public in a little bit of a way. But anyway, I guess getting ahead of ourselves, and we should save some of that for next time when we really get into the OxyContin part.
Yeah, the disgusting part.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's part one of Empire of Pain.
The patriarch. And the patriarch lived, and then he died. And we're going to see part two, which is called Dynasty, which you can imagine is about. I wonder how much the brothers are going to have to do with the next part. I'm kind of curious about that. But I think the big player from a little bit that I like kind of heard and the overview of the book is one of the sons.
Richard, right?
Yeah, yeah. I think he's the next kind of big patriarch figure.
He's also the guy that's featured prominently in the documentary.
Yeah, yeah. I believe he's also the one who got obsessed with studying the physiology of orgasms before he got into the OxyContin game.
Yep.
Yeah, something like that. Do you want to do any recommendations?
Sure, I have a recommendation.
Okay, sure. Go ahead.
My recommendation is Thank You for Smoking.
You're welcome.
The movie Thank You for Smoking, which is one of my all-time favorite movies. I'm terrible with actors' names because it's got some famous actors in it.
I've never seen the movie, and I can tell you the stars, Aaron Eckhart.
Yeah, that's the guy's name. Fucking great movie. Really liked it when it came out. I think I still really like it. And even though it's about cigarettes, it's very parallel to some of the same practices that I want to say the codeine, fentanyl, morphine market has employed in their ads, because the whole movie is about like advertising and cigarettes and how they pushed cigarettes so hard through advertising. And I think it's great.
I remember like realizing that Joe Camel was supposed to be like an evil cartoon when I was a little kid. Do you remember any of that shit? It was like the counter propaganda when people started to push back on cigarettes. You know what's funny though is I really remember that, and then my brand of cigarettes for a really long time was Camel Lights.
Mine were too. That was all I wanted to smoke when I was young.
Maybe that shit really worked on our stupid little kid brains. That dumb cartoon Camel.
I know I would have bought Red Apple cigarettes had they been a real thing.
Because you were watching tons of Tarantino as an 8-year-old.
Basically.
My recommendation is Going Clear, the documentary about Scientology, which was directed by the guy who directed Crime of the Century, the documentary we've been talking about the opioid epidemic. Going Clear, Scientology and the Prison of Belief is a really good documentary. It was pretty popular. I think a lot of people have seen it, but if you haven't, check it out. I would say even if you have, give it a second viewing, because I've viewed it more than once and found it, I don't know, it's got layers to it, I guess.
It does.
It's worth rewatching. You know, it's not a fun, I mean, no, what documentary is fun, really? They're all kind of, I mean, I guess there are some. But anyway, yeah, I recommend that. It's just very good. I mean, not much else to say about it other than like I've seen other Scientology documentaries that didn't go quite as deep, so it was just really impressive to see. Especially I think the most interesting thing about Scientology documentaries, and this one in particular, are how the majority of it is constructed of interviews with ex-members, and not just ex-members but like people that were high up in the institution who left. Going Clear, that's my recommendation.
All right, so where can we find ourselves on the internet?
I found myself once at Twitter at Heat Death Pod, and you made something once on the internet for us. What was
There's
that
also heatdeathpod.com.
yep. Check us out there. write to us about stuff, and maybe we'll read it on the air.
If you want to share your personal, anything personal about yourself, do it.
Anything. Just anything.
If you share a picture of your penis, I will describe it on air.
Oh, shit. We're inviting some. Thing is I was still, at this point, I'll be like...
I shouldn't say that.
Yeah, but I'm still, at this point, I'll still be like flattered. Hey, someone heard us and did what we said.
They made it to the end of the episode.
Exactly. Yeah. Or let's be specific. Have you seen Going Clear, the documentary? Have you been involved in Scientology? Have you been involved in any sort of cultish thing? We can do serious stuff too. Any connection to the opioid epidemic? Or have you read Empire of Pain? Have you seen Crime of the Century? And I guess leave it at that.
Yeah.
All right. Till next time.
Till next time.
Bye.
The first voice recording was made in 1860. It was a 10-second fragment of the French folk song Au Clair de la Lune recorded by inventor Edward Leon Scott de Martinville. But who will make the final voice recording and when? What will it be? Who will hear it?